Mike, I'm just so excited for many reasons. Many reasons. I love talking about ball, basketball specifically, but in this case, you've got what's been the old guard in some ways, the Golden State Warriors, and these new Jets, these new kids, led by number 12, the newest superstar in the NBA, Ja Morant. And so these teams are playing tonight. Warriors, Grizzlies. The Grizzlies have won 9 straight games. Ja Morant is doing incredible things every night. Sometimes it's scoring. Sometimes it's a chase down block. Sometimes
I still can't process that. I'm still trying to process that.
The elbow! The elbow was up there.
That was insane. That was insane.
So you've got the Warriors and Grizzlies playing tonight. It would be exciting. And that's the team, by the way. The Grizzlies knocked them out of the playoffs. They beat them in the play-in game. Got themselves into the playoffs, knocked the Warriors out. Yeah. It would be exciting enough if you just focus on the point guards, Ja Morant and Steph. But we get the bonus of Klay Thompson returning to this game. And he played 20 minutes in the first game
yesterday.
Back.
We didn't even get to that yesterday.
20 minutes?
What? That was
20 minutes?
That was
17?
Crazy. We were so caught up in Dunking the Sunday night football finish and Brian Flores's firing yesterday that we didn't even talk about the family affair that was Klay Thompson's return. Like, that was the thing that my kids said, that's what we want to watch. Like, that's what they sat down and said, hey, you know, we know there's football on, but like, this is what we watching. Is Klay Thompson coming back? And all of us collectively had goosebumps watching him be introduced, seeing the love that his teammates at the Chase Center, that the NBA community poured out. Everybody was just united in their happiness after 941 days to see Klay Thompson back. And my guy was like, I'm here to knock off the rust. Bro, did he shoot like 18 shots in 20 minutes? Dunking on people, crossing people up. I mean, I knew he would come back and be fine. I didn't know he would come back and look that good. We didn't even give him his flowers yesterday. We were so caught up in NFL drama. But yeah, no, absolutely. You're right. It's a big night for ball. It's a big ball night tonight.
Yeah, I mean, just think about that team. All right, so Golden State doing very well without Klay Thompson. And I know, you've been around long enough. I've been around long enough to know that you just don't get caught up in regular seasons. Even if it's a historic regular season, doesn't matter. When the playoffs start, people start approaching you differently. They start scouting you, playing you, starting to figure you out. And so there's a regular season way of playing. Then there's a postseason. You got to go to another level. So in a regular season, the Golden State Warriors look just fine without Klay Thompson. But now they've got the opportunity to kind of bring him along at a pace that's comfortable for them and comfortable for him, to a team that's already at the top of the Western Conference standings, get him back, get him reintegrated into the mix. And now they look like they're destined to go to the NBA Finals. However, you got Memphis. Memphis keeps pushing. It's almost like we can't figure out.
They're not a cute story anymore.
Yeah, you're right. We keep saying, hey, they're getting there. They're not quite.
No, they're there.
They're not quite ready yet. Oh, they're there. Both of them. Ja Morant's here.
We were treating the NBA just like the conversation we had a little while ago about college football. Like, Alabama, Georgia, everybody else, right? It's like, the Western Conference is Golden State, Phoenix, and everybody else. Like, nah, player. Like Memphis, this is no fluke. They were great without Ja, as it's been well documented. He comes back. Trains rolling, he takes them to a different level. I mean, look, the conventional wisdom around the NBA, Mike, is like you kind of got to go through things. You got to go through it to get to it.
NBA.com.
Well, last year, the Grizzlies went ahead and, experienced the playoffs. Ja Morant experienced the playoffs. He played well, but went out in the first round after they won that aforementioned play-in game against the Warriors. It's like, man, listen, the bracket could break a certain way. Injuries, COVID, bruh, I think you have to put the Grizzlies in the contender class. And, they've only won 9 in a row. And yes, it's regular season, but I think you have to put them in that class now. It's not, they're not in others, in that others group. They are in the contender class in the Western Conference. Would I still pick the Warriors, especially now that they have Clay back? Absolutely. But the Warriors, they're not without their flaws. They turn the ball over quite a bit, for example. You know, Memphis is good on offense. They're good on defense. They have a superstar that has no Fs to give in Ja Morant.
Right.
That could take over a game at any point. So Memphis, if the bracket breaks right, it wouldn't shock me to see Memphis emerge from the Western Conference. Not the way they're playing. Jaren Jackson.
Yeah.
Bane.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, they're a good team. That's my most intriguing storyline tonight going into it. As much as I love Clay, as much as I love seeing him back, for me, it's Memphis. I mean, and you know, I've called Steph Curry, you know, the greatest showman in the history of team sports. But that dude, Ja Morant, and Memphis, they are the most must-see team right now. They are the must-see TV team. They're the it team in the NBA, right?
And Memphis. Because
when a dude is doing chase down blocks one night, yamming on people, you know, all in the same game, really, doing chase down blocks, yamming on people, taking people off the dribble. I mean, you can't take your eyes off Memphis right now. So for me, I'm more looking forward, I'd say, to seeing what Ja Morant's got in store for tonight than I am. I kind of know, for the most part, even though Clay's been gone for 2 years, kind of know what I'm getting with Golden State for the most part.
But I don't.
I'm looking to see if Memphis, because if Memphis beats Golden State tonight, these kinds of conversations are going to be more common, if they aren't already, about where does Memphis stand in the pecking order? Are they not? If Memphis beats the Warriors.
Yeah, I think I agree with that. But you said something, you just said, you know what to expect from Klay Thompson. That's part of my intrigue, too. I don't really know what to expect. I don't. Because it's been 2 years. And I don't think that Klay Thompson is suddenly going to be become a bad shooter or something's missing.
Yeah, he looked fine the other night.
You don't just jump back in there, especially when you start thinking, because I don't play for Golden State, I don't play for Memphis, so I'm thinking ahead to the spring. When you start thinking about a playoff series and you're talking about 35, 38, sometimes 40 minutes within a 7-game series, how is he going to respond? How are they going to use him? How are the other players going to respond to him? How are the guys who were put into the role of scorers, how are they going to accept? I know he's got to do it. It's Klay Thompson. But how do they accept stepping back, scaling back a little bit? Even guys in the starting lineup like Wiggins. Wiggins is going to get fewer shots theoretically than he's been used to getting as a Golden State Warrior. Because
so what?
I'm not a member of his family. I'm not a member of his family. So if he's got hurt feelings over it, I don't care. What I'm saying is it takes a response. It takes some type of adjustment to the team to bring Klay Thompson back. You want to bring him back. It's not like you're bringing in somebody who can't play. You're bringing in a great player, and now everybody else has a different role outside of the obvious stuff. If it's an adjustment,
I think it's brief. And I know a lot of the faces have changed, but the culture around that team has always been one of adjusting. They adjusted to integrating the best player in the league into their team and taking a step back. So they've been there, done that, with taking a step back. And I don't know that anybody really took a step back. They all ate. Everybody eats B in Golden State. So I don't know that bringing somebody who is as beloved as Klay Thompson back. Man, again, he took 18 shots. He knocked all the rust off in one night, looked like. Nobody minded. Not to mention they've all been anticipating his return, looking forward to his return, knowing what his return could mean in terms of elevating them beyond their already lofty status, you know, in terms of how they performed so far this year. I don't think it's much of an adjustment at all. I think the day is dead when guys have to work their way back. I mean, the paradigm seems to have shifted.
Really?
I mean, just, well, in terms of injury, two major injuries. I think he took his time and put in the work. When's the last time somebody suffered a major or even catastrophic injury and they came back and they kind of like struggled and like looked unsure? I don't know if it's modern medicine, rehab, technology,
two guys,
mental health. Who comes to mind?
There are two guys.
Not Durant.
Now listen. Not on that level. But these were two all-star players who looked different post-injury. Victor Oladipo, you agree with me on that? Like Oladipo, before he got hurt, was balling. Now, you're not even thinking about him, right? And the other one is John Wall. Like, it's not the same.
I don't remember him dropping off a cliff, but maybe he wasn't the same guy he was. All I'm saying is,
for the most part,
I think people bounce back better than they once did. Achilles or ACL injuries are not the career death sentence that they once were. In fact, dudes coming back much quicker than they once did from those injuries. Not saying that everybody could do it, but based on what I saw one game in, it does not look like Klay Thompson is going to need a whole lot of time. Is there going to be an adjustment period? Does he have to ease his way back into carrying a full load? Yeah, but I don't think he's going to need a whole lot of time the way conventional and traditional wisdom would suggest.
I'm happy to see him back. And then on the flip side, Mike, don't you like going back to these moments when you recognize somebody is a superstar or you figure out when that superstar turn happened? So we really should have seen it coming. I was thinking about it. When did John Morant become a superstar? Really last year. It was the play-in game versus Golden State. And then, remember, game one, they took on Utah. And Utah's like, well, wait a minute. What? What happened? Now, ultimately, the Jazz won that series over the Grizzlies. But John Morant was there last year. He was a superstar last year. And I feel like Funkmaster Flex, John Morant is here. Funk says at the beginning of that Black Thought freestyle, Black Thought is here. You know what we do in this position. Black Thought is here. Ja Morant is here to stay, and he came first, and the Memphis Grizzlies had no business. They had no choice but just follow him. They followed him. So he's a superstar.
It's not just him. They got a squad. They got a team. They were really good without him for a reason. So they built something very intriguing there. That if it doesn't already by now, with 9 straight wins, and it's definitely got everybody's attention. That's for damn sure. And after tonight,
Do they win tonight?
Yes, Memphis wins at home tonight. And more people are talking about Memphis as contenders tomorrow than already are after they beat Golden State tonight.
Hey, thanks for watching Brother from Another on YouTube. Make sure you hit subscribe before you leave and be sure to watch us 3 to 5 p.m. Eastern Time on Peacock. Appreciate you.